I feel like this is a really important question because people, they don't really understand how all the translation comes together and how do you come at it. In their minds, it might be too simple. Why do another translation? All the others are just fine. So just wanting to understand the approach and what's your approach in context of the translation and just the dynamics of all that.
You know, just by way of preface, I'll just say that I've been really humbled by this process because I think of the number of times where, because of maybe lack of understanding, I've maybe bashed a certain translation. It may not have been the one I was used to, and this isn't a good translation. And now, having been on this side of the process, it's just really humbling to see, you know, how language is a complex thing, let alone a language that, you know, we're more than 2,000 years separated from the original context. And, you know, I've studied, you know, I've in across cultural situations, I've studied language in an intensive way, and it's hard in a modern context where you can actually go to the person and ask them questions and learn from them, a live person. And so then, you know, you add to that the cultural gaps, you add to that the time gaps, and it's really been humbling. And I realized, man, I've got to really be careful before I just make snap judgments or accusations against a certain translation for this. You know, all translators, they have reasons for what they do, and you may not agree with the reasons. I think certain reasons are better than others, but they're not just doing it haphazardly. That's a lot of time to give to something that haphazard, you know. And so as to approach, you know, I tend to be more of a generalist in the sense of I like to glean insights from multiple disciplines. You know, most of my own personal training are in field. You know, I studied philosophy when I was in college and in history. And then my master's I did in missiology. And all of those tend to, you know, especially philosophy and missiology, they lend themselves to interdisciplinary approaches. So philosophy, you know, basically it's just asking the question why, and you can apply that question to any field. And or missiology, it's more, you know, there's definitely specific concentrations you can have in how to engage in mission. And part of mission would be translation, especially if you're trying to communicate the scriptures by translating them into another language. And so, you know, missiologists would tend to be more, you know, they would draw from many disciplines to try to integrate those insights so that the gospel can be effectively communicated in different ways. And so the reason I say that is because that has its strengths and its weaknesses for sure. You know, today knowledge is so specialized in academic settings. You know, you can go, study, you know, the bibliography. And if you're a PhD in history, I mean, just massive, lots of pages of your bibliography, but it's very specialized. And so, when you're drawing from all of them, you're depending on them to make their insights available to the non-specialist to be able to apply them. And so, thankfully, there are lots of resources out there that are doing that. I'm really thankful for that. And so I would just say my approach is interdisciplinary and trying to integrate the insights from different fields and different perspectives. For example, you can look at the translation philosophy. You know, I remember when I was in studying with he was a missions guy, and his focus was anthropology, talking about translation one time. He talked about a certain culture where they had a hard time, they didn't have so much expressing the concept of forgiveness, kind of as an abstract term of forgiveness, showing mercy to somebody who's wronged you, something like that, where they were really, the translators were wrestling with how can we communicate the biblical concept of forgiveness. As English speakers, you know, we've got a long history of this language, and so may not be a big issue, but in this particular culture, it was a difficult issue. How, you know, to actually communicate that. And so they actually had a custom, and the custom was that if two people needed to be reconciled, then what they would do once they were reconciled, one would spit corn at the feet of the other person. And so the translator said, okay, let's go for a dynamic rendering here. And they translated it as, you know, the passage from the Sermon on the Mount, if you forgive those who sin against you, your Heavenly Father will forgive you, but if you don't forgive them, neither will He forgive you. They translated it as, if you spit corn at other people's feet, then your Heavenly Father will spit corn at your feet. And for some reason, that example stuck with me. Wow, language is complex. Language is complex. And, you know, in certain situations, you know, to talk about God spitting corn at your feet, you know, is that in the Greek? You know what I'm saying? You get all these controversies about the different translations, philosophies. But in an interdisciplinary approach, there are certain instances where a more literal approach is appropriate, and you're going to lose insight and what the scripture is trying to say if you don't go with a more literal approach, a formal correspondence approach. And, you know, most Bibles will have at least a brief version of what that means at the beginning. And there'll be times where if you do go with that approach, you'll lose the meaning big time, especially with idioms. And so when it comes to translation philosophy, the ironic thing, in my opinion, is that sometimes giving something, the translations that are stereotyped as being more literal, in my opinion, there are places where they could be more literal, and by being more literal, they end up being more dynamic, meaning they have a greater impact. And there's other places where the translations that are stereotyped as being dynamic, not a paraphrase necessarily, but trying to communicate the thought and the meaning behind it, not necessarily just the exact words, where they probably aren't being dynamic enough to communicate the meaning of something. Just to give you an example of that, one passage when I was growing up as a kid, you know, I'd read the Bible and just went over my head every time, and it just confused me. And it's Romans 12. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Well, obviously, that's an idiom there. That's a Hebrew idiom. I had no idea what that meant growing up. I mean, to heap burning coals on somebody's head, you know, it sounded, to be honest, my first impression was that sounds a little vindictive. You know, I'm trying to get back at him. But then you do a little homework, and you realize, yeah, I think the Net Bible has this in one of their footnotes on the original context of this, where it talks about that this is a Hebrew idiom for provoking somebody's conscience and awakening their conscience in a sense. And because the head is, you know, it could be considered the seat of the conscience, if you will. And so your good actions and your good acts are stimulating their conscience to consider God. And in my opinion, you know, even in the translations that would be considered more dynamic, you know, they might be dynamic in trying to figure out how to communicate the words better or something. But that's an example where a more dynamic rendering, there's no reason why you shouldn't translate that idiom as, in doing this, you'll provoke their conscience. See what I'm saying? That would be a perfect example, in my opinion, where something needs to be more dynamic. And so it's really more of an art than a science. And that's one thing, you know, any of the translations will say that, you know, anybody who's involved in it, that if you're so rigid that you are applying one particular method and philosophy at every single instance for whatever reasons, then, you know, you'll probably lose something in it. And so to bring those different insights from the translation philosophy side of things, other fields such as the traditional grammars, you know, right now there's a lot of discussion happening between traditional Greek grammarians and linguists. And I think that conversation is proving more and more fruitful. But there's just certain things that you just need there's just got to be a good grammatical base on, you know, prepositional phrases, clauses, things like that. And there's a lot of issues on that level that have imp- implications for exegesis and interpretation. And so being able to take the foundational knowledge that a good solid Greek grammar is going to give you, taking those insights and then integrating those with some of the insights that are coming from linguistics now. And a lot of times those two fields, just like any other field of knowledge, there's always conflict, and hopefully conflict leads to greater understanding rather than just being mean to each other, although sometimes that happens. Lots of opinions out there on these things, especially strong opinions on translation, I've noticed. I'm like, Laura, do I really want to walk into this world? You know, sometimes just you read certain things and, you know, certain convictions that come out, and you can understand the reason for the convictions, but learning to express conviction in ways that show respect and communicate love at the same time, you know, I'm growing in that myself in a lot of ways. But the point being that the insights coming from linguistics now, recently I've been reading, just trying to, in preparation for the final next phases of the translation project I've been working on, doing some more research and trying to refine my understanding and things like that. I've been so blessed by some of the things that in the field of linguistics apply to New Testament studies, things that supplement what you're getting from the traditional grammars. And Steve Runge, he's got a book, Discourse, Grammar of the Greek New Testament. Just some of the insight that he's bringing, and I really appreciate Mr. Runge, because he works at Logos Bible Software. I really appreciate him because he's taken a lot of time to really go deep in the field of linguistics, and it's a very specialized field. I mean, very technical field, and to make some of the insights available to little people like us, and there's just been a few times even recently where I feel like I've read the scripture, been reading the scriptures for the first time in a lot of ways. And so I come across resources like that, and I think, man, there's no reason why some of these insights can't be incorporated into an English translation. And so, and then of course the worldview issues. I mean, as thankful as I am for all the for the translations that are available, there are places where, you'll come across a place and I'll just have to, just to be honest, you know, I'll be suspicious of, man, I wonder if there's some Platonism influencing this. Now it's, you know, you don't want to go from that into ad hominem arguments where you're attacking people and assuming things about why they do this or that. So don't want to make that step, but to be able to look at it and say, you know, to be able to look at that and make just evaluate, you know, is this translation in accord with the blessed hope of the gospel understood within the framework of the restoration of all things, rather than heavenly destiny and Gnosticism and things like that. It's just one of the realities that there is a lot of Greek thinking that has been, biblical clothing has been put on that thinking, and it's in a lot of churches and things like that. So I do. That is one of the aspects, being able to bring the worldview side of it as well to bear. And we just in the car yesterday, we talked about one little genitive construction, and the way you would translate that based on possibly your worldview on just that one little phrase, the way you would understand the nature of the human body, and if you were to translate. A particular genitive in a particular way within the various 50 billion ways you can translate a genitive in Greek. And so so that's my approach. You know, it's interdisciplinary prayer. You know, this, I just feel like I'm constantly being driven to my face in this project, and trying to integrate various, figure out ways to bring these insights together. You know, it's like cracking nuts. You know, how much of the meat do you want to get to? And I want to be able to capture as much of it as we can without overstepping in doing so. And so in the midst of that, being able to get the input and feedback from others is key. Speaking of which, you know, I pray for you guys to I'd ask you guys, whoever's watching this interview, to pray. I have certain individuals that I'd like to get feedback from these different perspectives and fields that have more expertise in these areas, to get their input and make adjustments. And so people are busy, and just praying for the Lord to open those doors. So.